Hello everyone, today we will talk about C fundamentals, what elements we find in a C program, and about the number systems that we will use. The elements of a C program are preprocessor directives, keywords, identifiers, constants, strings, special symbols, operators, and also we have non-functional elements like comments that we will see later. So let's start with the preprocessor directives. These preprocessor directives are 11 in total, and we will investigate all of them in this lesson. We will create a new project. New project, C project. We'll give the name lesson 2. And we will create one source file. Let's say l2.c. So, which was the first preprocessor directive? It was the include one. So this one we also see in the previous lesson. Include less than greater than symbols and inside stdio.h. So what this preprocessor directive does? It will include the header file stdio.h and it will paste it inside our l2c file. This is done before compiling, so it's done at the preprocessing time. We shall also say here that we also have the include followed by double quotation marks. Which is used to include the user-defined header files. So let's define one. New header file. It also created 3 preprocessor directives in our header file. We'll see in a moment what they are. So this is, with the double quotes, you shall always include project user-defined header files. And with the less than and greater than symbols, you will include system header files. Next preprocessor directive. It's the hash symbol define, also called as macro. Let's see how it is used. A macro is a segment of code which will be replaced by the value of the macro. There are 2 types of macro. We have object-like macro and we have function-like macro. So we will explore both of them now. Define. Let's say we want a macro with the name pi and the value of the macro 3.1415. So this is the object-like macro. The next type of the macro, function-like macro, we will explore it now. Define max of a and b. This is the function like macro, and we will use as value the result of a ternary operator. The ternary operator acts on 3 arguments. The first one is the conditional argument. So if a is greater than b, the name of the 2 parameters of our function like macro. Now we put a question mark and we enter the next 2 arguments. A, if the condition before was true, it will return the A value. If not, colon B, it will return the B in case of false. So now let's see an example in the main function. For that, we have to write the main function. Int main void let's print py value first. We will use printf formatting. So for the floating values, we will use the percent symbol, how many precision digits, 4, and f is the specifier. And also we will return the new line character. So what we will print here is the macro object like p. Build. Also we have forgot to return 0 at the end. Let's return now. Build again. And let's run the program. For that we have to click the run. Run. Local C, C++ application. OK. So this will change our launch here to the lesson 2. We also have the Hello World executable. But now we are in the lesson 2 and we will run the lesson 2 executable. So here is the value. This is the macro object like. Now let's see the function like macro. Printf. Max from 5 and let's say 20 is percent d to print an integer on the console, and here we will insert the function like macro max called with parameters 5 and 20. Build, launch. So indeed it's 20. Let's say if this was 50, run, the result is 50. Next precursor directive is the undef. The undef will cancel a definition of a define. For example, undef py. Build again. We will get an error that the py is undeclared because this precursor directive has cancelled the macro from above. So this printf statement is not executable anymore. Next preprocessor directive. IfDef. We have also to mention that IfDef, IfNDef, and if shall always end with the endif. Let's see. IfDef py and if. What this does? If def py, it will execute this statement between the if def and if and if. Let's build. Run. The py is not executed. The py statement. To solve this, we have to comment out the undef or to delete it. Let's see how we can comment out a line of code. We can use this single line comment like this, slash slash. Now the line of code is commented out and it will not be compiled anymore. Let's see. Now the pi statement prints on our console. That's because the pi is defined in our file and the undef doesn't have an effect anymore because it's commented out. Let's see the other type of the comment. The other type of the comment, we can have multi-line comment. So you have to begin with slash, asterisk, insert whatever you like, and end with the asterisk, slash. So this is a multi-line comment. If and def. Like the if def, the if and def will execute everything that it's inside only if the macro given here is not defined. In our case, the macro is defined and the printf will not be executed. Next, we have the if, else, elif. Let's see them in action. For example, if we have to insert a logical statement. If 5 greater than 2, printf something. Then let's say elif 10 is smaller than 20, printf this, else with the preprocessor hash symbol, else printf hello from else. And we shall end with the endif. What will happen? Because the first evaluation will be true, the printf of the pi value will be on our console. Let's see. As expected. If we will make this 20, the next true one will be printed on our console. We see here that now the max is printed. Let's also make this false. Now we are in the else case. Let's run. Hello from else. So this is how the preprocessor directives if, elif, else works. Next preprocessor directive, error. This preprocessor directive you will only use if you really want to give an error to the console. Not to the console, to the compiler. You can also enter a text inside, doesn't matter, because when the compiler will encounter this error, it will give a compile error, like this. If you don't want the error, you need to have something true from above, because I have inserted the error in the else branch. Okay. Next preprocessor directive, pragma. Pragma will be used to give additional information to the compiler. We will cover pragma in a future lecture, because pragma is compiler dependent and we have to read the manual of the compiler to know exactly what pragma does. So we will continue our lesson. Keywords. Keywords are predefined or reserved words in a programming language. Each keyword is meant to perform a specific function in a program. Since keywords are referred names for a compiler, they can't be used as variable names. You cannot redefine keywords. C language supports 32 keywords. This is true only for C90 standard, because in C99 they have added the keyword inline, for example. But in general, you will encounter all of these keywords. So we will learn in our future lesson all of these 32 keywords and the inline one. The other special one included with C standard 11, 17, maybe we will only mention them. But for now, we will concentrate on the C90 standard. So we have these keywords. We can identify four of them: int, void. There are only three of them: int, void, and return. These are the C keywords. Main is the name of the identifier, so it's not a keyword. Now, next we have the identifiers. Identifiers are used as the general terminology for naming of variables, functions, and arrays. As we saw here, main. This is the name of the identifier. Identifier names must differ in spelling and case. We have to say here that C language is a case-sensitive language. So, there is a distinction between variables in uppercase letters and the same word in lowercase. C language is case sensitive. You cannot use keywords as identifiers. The compiler will give you an error. They must begin with a letter or underscore. So the letters that we can use are the English alphabet letters. We see them down here. And the underscore is the underscore. So they must begin with a letter or the underscore. The underscore name of variables you will encounter for the compiler variables and the system variables. We as users, we will not use the underscore naming. They must not contain white space. This is self-explanatory. They shall be up to 31 characters long. Anything after this 31 length will be ignored. Also, you can insert numbers inside the identifiers. So you can also use numbers, but you cannot start with a number. Another identifier is the macro identifier, pi, max, printf. It's also name of a function from the standard input-output library. So this is also an identifier. Next, most common programming case types. We mention here five program case types. In C language, we will encounter camel case for variable names, snake case for compiler variables, but we as users depend on the coding guidelines. Most of the time we use the camel case. And for the name of the function, we use the Pascal case. Exception will be this main function, which starts with the M in lowercase. Uppercase snake case, we use them for the macro objects or macro function like. We have all letters in uppercase, and we have the snake case that adds an underscore between words. Kebab case is not seen in C language, so don't use this case. Next C program element are the constants. Their values cannot be modified by the program once they are defined. Let's see. We have the pi. The pi cannot be modified by the program. So this is our constant. let's say we want to assign a new value, pi equal to 10. It will not let you. Let's define another constant. We will use another keyword of C language, const. Const will give it a type, int for integer, my var equal 10. My var is also a constant. So my var cannot be changed. Assignment of read-only variable. So these are constants. We can also have character constants, string constants, and that's all. Next, strings. They are an array of characters ended with a null character. \0. We see here an array of characters. We don't see that they are ended with the \0, but let's define one. Now define, let's make a constant string, const char, my string, let's say, of three elements, equal to characters are enclosed between single quotation mark. So let's say A, B, and we have to end the string. Let's print it. We have forgot to put the semicolon. It's very important. So here is the string, AB. This is a string. Also, this is a string between double quotation marks. Next element of a C program or elements. Special symbols. We have the brackets used for the arrays, parentheses used for the function calls and function parameters, braces. They mark the start and the end of a block of code. We have the comma used for separating parameters. We have the asterisk. This is used to create pointer variable. We will see in a future lecture what a pointer is and how many types of pointer can we have. We have the assignment operator. We saw this before. We have the preprocessor. Hash symbol, we also have this semicolon, which we have forgotten to put in our previous example. Okay, so this is the assignment special character. This is a special character, this. Now let's go further. Okay, there are some languages that don't have on their keyboard the braces or the brackets or the hash symbol, so you have to use a trigraph character. Trigraph because we have to insert three characters. So every time, first two characters will be double question mark, and after that, if you put the equal sign, then it means this is a hash symbol. So that means we can write here double question mark and equal. So this is a trigraph character which will replace the hash symbol. Let's build. Okay, we have expected something error, but first of all, we have to tell the compiler that we will use the tree graphs. So for that, we go to the lesson, properties, C, C++ build, settings, miscellaneous, and let's say we want the tree graph. Tree graph. Like this, tree graphs, plural. Apply, apply, build. We have a warning that the double question marks and the equal was converted to the hash symbol, but it's a warning. So this one was compiled. Let's run. It works. Let's see another tree graph. Let's see these curly braces. So the other tree graph is double question mark and less than sign. This will replace the open curly brace. And to close the curly brace, we have double question mark and greater than sign. This will close the curly brace. Build. We have some warnings. It will tell us what was converted. So it was as expected and it also runs. Good. Next, let's see the other special character. Digraph. Digraph replaced tree graphs because they were not so safe to use the tree graphs. So let's see now the digraph in action. We have the percent sign and a colon for the hash symbol, and we have the less than sign and the colon for the square bracket, but we are interested in these curly braces, so we have the less than sign and the percent. Let's see. We will replace now tree graphs with digraphs. Also, we can mix them together. Let's see. Modulo, how it was? Modulo, colon. So this is the digraph that will replace the hash symbol. And let's replace one, only one. Let's see. Build. We have the warnings only for the tree graphs. That's why they were also replaced. For the digraphs, we don't have no warnings. Run. So this was presented so that you can understand if someday you will have a piece of code that uses the tree graphs or digraphs, and you need to understand it. So now you do. Also, if you want to participate to Obfuscated C contest, I will give you a link. Let's see. So let's search for EOCCC. This is the International Obfuscated C Code Contest. And in here you will see many strange C code. Like, let's see some winning entries. Let's see this one. This one is just the help. Let's see the one from Adamovsky. So in here, this one obfuscate C code. It does something. We will not get into detail what it does, but it does. This is obfuscated C code. Another one. We have something. This is not so obfuscated. Let's see another one. Okay, this is more interesting one. Now let's close. Next element, operators. Operators are symbols that triggers an action when applied to C variables and other objects. Straightforward. The data items on which operators act upon are called operands. Depending on the number of operands that an operator can act upon, operators can be classified as follows: unary operators, binary, and ternary. Let's see. We have unary operators, increment, decrement. Also, we have the negation, logical negation, and the negation of bits. The ternary one we have seen is this question mark and the colon, and the rest of them are binary operators, so they act on two operands. We will see them in action in future lessons. So I think we have discussed about all the elements that a C program has. Let's look at our code. Okay. Next, we have the number systems that we will use in our C code. We have the decimal number system, binary, octal, and hexadecimal. Decimal. It's a base 10 numerical system. We have the symbols from 0 to 9, as we all know. And the example of a C variable is this short integer, the identifier, name of the variable, the assignment operator, 2020, the year that we are now, and the special symbol, semicolon. Binary. Binary is a base 2 numerical system. We have the symbols 0 and 1. Example of a C variable, we have here an unsigned char. Very important, binary numbers start with 0 and a b, lowercase b. So this indicates us that it will follow a binary number. So in here we have this binary number. Octal. Octal is a base 8 numerical system. Symbols are from 0 to 7. And such an example is this unsigned char, octal value, equals 0, 12. Now, to identify the octals in our code, they must start with a 0. If they don't start with a 0, then we have a decimal value. If you see a number with a 0 in front, then that one is an octal one. Next, hexadecimal, base 16. So this has the symbols from 0 to 9. And also, in addition, it has the letter alphabets from A to F. So A means 10, B 11, C 12, D 13, E 14, and F 15. Example of such a C variable, we have this one. To note here, the hexadecimal values or numbers start with the 0x in front of them. So that's it. Now we will see some math conversion between different numerical systems. For example, let's see how to convert 202 into binary. So for this, we will use the division method. We divide 202 by 2. This is the base system that we want to reach. And the result will be 101 with the rest 0. Then we will take the 101, we will divide this by 2, and the result will be 50.5. We take this 0.5, multiply by 2 with the base, and this will be our remainder, 1. Next, we take the 50, divided by 2, we have 25, remainder of 0. We take the 25, divided by 2, we have 12.5. We multiply 0.5 with the base, we get the remainder 1. We continue like this. And we we will stop when we will see a zero. After we see this zero, we will read our binary number from these remainders. So, to read this, we have to start from above. This will be the least significant bit, so the LSB, and below this will be the most significant bit. So our number is 0101001. For this, we will open up the calculator. We will go to the programmer and let's enter here decimal 202. So let's put this here, here the calculator. So we have the 0, least significant bit. We have the 10 10 100 10 0 1 1. So this is the division method. Next, we can also do this from decimal to octal. We now divide by the base 8. So, as with the binary, we take the what's after the point. We multiply that by the base and we will have our remainder. Let's see. 202 in octal is 312. So 3, most significant number, and this is the least significant number. So 312. We can do this also for the hex. We divide it by 16 and we will get the CA. You can calculate this on a piece of paper. And you can do this for all the numbers that you can imagine. Next, I have also did decimal to decimal to see if we have the 202 result. So we have. Now the next method to convert from these numerical systems that are not decimal to the decimal. We use the power multiplication and the sum of the of this power multiplication. So for the number in binary format, least significant bit and most significant bit, so this is 0101001, which is equivalent to 202. We will do it like this. The first least significant bit, we take the value from here and we multiply by its power from because it's the first position, the power of the 2 will be 0. Next we have 1 multiplied by 2 to the power of 1. Next 0 multiplied by 2 to the power of 2 and so on. Here we have the powers of 2, 1, 2, 4 and so on. So the result will be only the sum where we have a 1. So 1 multiplied by 2 to the power of 7 is 1 multiplied by 128. So we make this 128 plus 64 plus 8 from here plus 2 from here. So the result is 202. This can also be applied to the octal system. We have the power of 8. The same as with the power of 2s, we have the power of 8. So 3 multiplied by 8 to the power of 2, 192, because it's 3 multiplied by 64. Then we have 1 multiplied by 8 with the power of 1, so this is will be only 8. And we have 2 times 8 to the power of 0. Any number raised to the power of 0 will give us a 1. So 2 times 1 gives us 2. So this will be equal to 202. Next, we have the hexadecimal. So C, as I said you before, its equivalent is 12 in decimal, and A is 10. So we have 12 multiplied by 16 to the power of 1, 192, and 10 multiplied by 16 to the power of 0. So it's 10 multiplied by 1, so it's 10. 192 plus 10 equal 202. I also did for the decimal to decimal. So now we have the power of 10s. So 2 times 10 to the power of 2 is 2 times 100, so this will give us 200. This is a 0, and 2 multiplied by 1 will give us 2, so the sum will be 202. So everything is as in our calculator. A word about this calculator: you can see the full keypad like this. It will change with the number system that you select here: hexadecimal, decimal, octal, and binary. Also, you have this bit toggling keypad. So in here you can toggle the bits using your mouse. And to mention here, this is a quad word. This is a 64 bit length variable, let's say like that. So to change this quad word, you click on this. Click, now we have a double word. This is a 32 bit variable. One more time, we have the word. This is a 16 bit variable. And press one more time, we will see something interesting. We have the byte. So the byte has only 8 bits. But what we will see here at the result? We see that the decimal value is minus 1. Why is that? Is that because the computer represents the negative numbers in 2's complement. So 1111, it's 2 complement is minus 1. If you take out the negative part, we have 127. But let's see how this 2 complement is formed. So for that I have an example here. In theory, also in the past, maybe you heard about this representation of negative values. So we have the sign magnitude, which is the easiest way to represent a negative value. You just flip the last bit, the most significant bit, you flip it from 0 to 1 to have the negative. So what you have to do is to write the number in binary format as positive, and you flip the most significant bit and you have the negative part. This right here, sign magnitude, is not used anywhere. It's just in theory. Next, we have the ones complement. The ones complement is the complementation of the positive value. So, to have negative 15 in base 10, we write the positive part in binary format and we complement each bit. So 1 becomes a 0 and 0 becomes a 1. So this is the ones complement. This is also not used because you have negative 0 and positive 0. So what is this? This is not met. You cannot have a 0 with plus sign and minus sign. So the solution to this is the 2's complement. So this 2's complement is used in our daily life computers, microcontrollers, embedded systems. So the data that is stored on that controller is in 2 complement. To make the 2 complement, you have to first write your number in positive form. Then you have to extract 1 from it, and after that do the 1's complement. Or you do the 1's complement and you add 1 binary to it. Let's see. Decimal. let's change here to the quad word to have a full range of numbers. Okay, so let's represent negative 50. Negative 15. Negative 15. Negative, I say. Maybe let's stick to the byte because it's easier to look at it. So here it is. You have the positive, this one. Then you make the ones complement and you add one to it. So this is the part of the ones complement. And this one is the one that you have to add to have the twos complement. So let's see what happens if you remove the sign, because the sign will always be there. The most significant bit will also be used in the twos complement and ones complement and also the sign magnitude anytime. Let's see what happens. So this is not positive 50, 15, if you expected that. That will be in case of sign magnitude, just to flip the most significant bit. The data that is represented in your memory is in two complement. So that's the lesson of today. If you like the video, please give it a like, share and subscribe.